for Ms. Divergen.
Thanks, Shreya. Thanks for the introduction. I did a startup in ML, which was about almost 9 to 10 years back. And since then, I have, you know, part of Box, which acquired that startup. And then I was part of Johnson Controls, where we were doing AI for industrial companies. And then finally, right now, I've been at Adobe for about 18 months and looking at their machine learning platform. And so thanks for coming and listening to this. One thing that I would like to say is that I saw that over a period of time, like for last few years when people were talking about machine learning, they were talking about a lot around models, their accuracy, and how deep learning has, you know, just taken it to a different level. And I was looking at the agenda today, and many talks are about really making it production worthy, taking it to the products. What does it mean to take a machine learning model and make it a part of the product? And the same journey, if you take it further, is like not only on the cloud, but how do you make it available on the devices? And that's the area that I want to look at it, which is still a very green field, very new, and there's still a lot of challenges that happens. In my talk today, I'll focus more on the challenges we faced at Adobe. So it's more like a case study kind of a thing. But, you know, many things out of that will be relevant in different ways for people who are using it in different forms and fields and everything. So what we'll do is that we'll go over a little bit about what on-device ML is, because it means different things to different people. I'll touch base a little bit about the use cases, why do you even need it, and then some of the challenges that we faced. I know that this talk is referenced as a technical talk, and I had to up-level it a little bit, like not going into the weeds, so bear with me. But please feel free to ask any questions as we do it. So before I start, just wanted to give you a little bit of a background that the whole ML infrastructure and machine learning framework at Adobe is under an umbrella called Adobe Sensei, and the full, basically the principle around this is to bring the art and science together, because Adobe, being a creative company with all of its product suites around Photoshop, Illustrator, and a lot of Aero around 3D and AR, VR, and everything, there is a lot of design and a lot of art that is related to its product, but also a lot of machine learning and intelligence associated with those products. So our idea is, like, internally, whenever we talk about AI, the idea is not about artificial intelligence, but it's more about augmented intelligence. And that's the way we want to. We don't want to be in the way of the creator. We want to help the creator to get to the next level. And how do we think about it? So so let's go a little bit on, so on-device ML. So now that we know that we have so many applications that where the people are actually using it to do their day-to-day work. It's not something that people are coming there just to browse. So it's not Instagram, it's not Facebook, it's Photoshop. People actually spend time into doing and creating something new out of it. And these are the applications that they don't work, like there are versions, but lighter versions for the cloud and web. But most of it are applications that run on your devices. So for us, the definition of device, again, is not just mobile phones, it's also your laptops, it's also your iPads. Those are the places where things run. So now the variety of the devices for us is very different, very varied. Again, I want to make sure that, so when I was at Johnson Controls and Tyco and we were doing machine learning on devices, over there, the meaning of devices was completely different because we were working on, you know, smart lights or smart smoke detectors. And so even in that case, we had a good handle on what the hardware will look like, which hardware we are working on. in this particular case, when we are actually looking for consumers, just the variety of things that are out there and how they use it, what is their preference of upgrades or connectivity, and everything is so varied that it makes the problem much more challenging. So this is really a problem where we are thinking of machine learning at scale in a very, very varied kind of an environment. But it does have its benefits, like latency definitely is one of the biggest thing that people ask for, especially the type of content that we are dealing with. Not just videos definitely is very big. Now, even if something is hosted on the cloud, just the amount of time it will take for you to, you know, send the video to the cloud, get it and come back, is not something that is acceptable. So you would want something to be running locally for the latency that you would be looking for when you are working with a video. And it's not just video, even the files like the Photoshop files or even the PDFs, they can be very, very huge. And to send it all the back to the server and get the result back may not be acceptable. So there are definitely use cases where you do want some of the machine learning features to run on the devices. And so that's there. And also the privacy, till the time, this is your work. It's not just about some of the information, but like real work that you are doing. Brands are very particular about, like, if they're creating a new logo, you don't want that to leak out in any which way that they can really protect it. So this brings in a good, you know, privacy concerns. Also personalization. Everybody has a different way of even cropping. So the way I like to crop my pictures will always be different from how you like to do it and how you like to do it. So if you are doing machine learning on the devices, that kind of personalization and really adapting to the way you like to do things becomes much more easier, rather than if it is going back to the server and you're storing that information and, you know, making the global model updated. Availability is something that we take for granted, right? Like, we are always connected to internet. These power outages, I don't know how many of you were affected. I was affected. The Wi-Fi goes down. Anything that we have is a phone, but all the other devices were literally not working. And then I come to this conference and power is still there, but connectivity is still very poor. Like, it took me a long, long time to download this PowerPoint onto my device, just because sometimes, so we take it for granted, but it's not always available. And to have something, like, I did have to make some changes, and there was no way I could have done it if I was doing it only on cloud. So on-device becomes important as we see the use cases, the people, how they're using it, and they're coming up. Cost is another big factor. So right now, we are developing a lot of models around using GANs. We are doing some, you know, very complicated thing of masking. All of those models are pretty huge, and they, you know, they have hundreds of layers, they are big. And even in the inference side, when we are trying to run them, they take and scale it to the millions of users that we have across the world. The number of GPUs and everything that you will have up and running at all the time is huge. And in that particular case, you will be spending a lots and lots of money. Like, that is basically a cost that you are incurring. And if you have it running on the device, if you have really compressed it, make it in the form that it can run on the users, that's something still to be, proven, but I think that should help you save some money around that. So there are definitely benefits, but then the challenges comes with it, and that's what we are going to discuss it a little bit more in the details. But the idea is that there is, you know, resources definitely are limited. Laptops are still okay. You still have some power in there connected, but when you're talking about mobile devices or iPads and things like that, that's definitely very challenging. The biggest challenge, like I mentioned earlier, is just the variations that is out there. Everybody, like, across the globe just has such different hardware, and to make something that will work optimally for each of those hardwares, and how do you handle when things are not working, it just makes the problem really challenging. So before cloud, I don't know how many of you are, you know, I see all the young faces, but there are who like understand like what were the challenges before cloud when we used to ship the product to the upgrades and everything used to be very challenging because some customers would be on version 2.0 and we have moved to version 5.0, nothing is upgraded. And it was all very difficult to make the, you know, new features work on it. And with cloud, that gave us a lot of, you know, control on the environment that we were running things. And it became very smooth and same. And it was just, but with these devices, that challenge, I feel, is coming back in a much, much bigger way. Because we are not just shipping, this is not our hardware. Hardware is something that the user is buying. And we need to support it, so it becomes a much bigger challenge. So that's like a summary of what on-device ML brings and the challenges that it brings. So we'll talk a little bit more around it, but I just want to kind of show you some of the examples of the use cases that we have been using ML for. So this one is auto reframe, and if it works. So the idea here is to capture the most relevant frame. So if you are cropping and if you are cropping just in the middle, you will lose like as the things are moving. In this particular case, the smart crop is able to focus on the real things and really do it right there. So you never see an empty frame. If it was very particular right in the center or for a bigger frame, then it wouldn't move. But in this particular case, it's able to do it. So it's machine learning, but now think of it, you are doing that, you want to put it on Instagram or put it on anywhere, and now you have to send the video all the way back to the cloud, get it back, it will be too much, rather than detecting that object and making that crop right there on the devices. So similarly, this one is another example. Let me see. Okay, I don't know if how to, the voice will. So this is again a video and you want to edit a video on. And this is needed many a times when the creators are actually creating the content for something. So they have like videos available outside, which has a lot of people, but that's not the one that you can use. So you want to modify it and like everything is clear. And it basically fills it according to the things over there. So these kind of things require really low latency and a good experience. Otherwise, it's very difficult for people to use it. So After Effects uses this particular thing also. So these were some of the use cases. There are many more. And that is where you would want to think about using ML on devices. Now, when we started looking, so like I said, if it is going to be a case study, let me just start. So we started on this project sometime last year, less than a last year, so sometime beginning of like January of 2019. And the moment you start looking into what are the things that are available, there's just a vast amount of things happening on all the layers. There are hardware libraries that people are working on, really optimizing it for the different devices. There are low-level libraries like CUDNN, NNAPIs, and then there are inference libraries, and it's something which is a very emerging field. So it's happening all over the stack, and it becomes really difficult for you to basically settle for one thing or the other. And even in that case, when we started looking into it and the wide variety of applications that we have and the wide variety of solutions that we have, it was very difficult for us to really come up with one solution, to say that, okay, we are going to go with Core ML or we are going to go with TF Lite. And the reason being that none of these things right now is something that works across the hardware, or nothing is something which is optimized completely. Even they are coming up with new versions at all the time. So this is just a flavor again. Like, I don't think that I have captured each and everything that is outside. I'm pretty sure that I have missed. But just to give you a flavor of the things that are happening in the field. So the first, very, very first challenge that we faced when we were thinking about the solution was about what do we do? Like, which framework do we go with and how do we make it so that we are not putting ourselves into one corner? We can make the changes as they are emerging in the ecosystem, in the industry, and we are able to still deliver a solution that is actually working for that particular hardware. So Microsoft has WinML, and that works, you know, awesomely for Windows operating system, but then CoreML works for iOS and Core OS, and whereas and like TF-Lite works pretty well for Android. But it's like, even though TF-Lite says that it works CoreML at the, you know, behind the scenes and everything, but if you start really comparing the performances and everything, you will see a lot of differences, and it becomes challenging for you to really choose one over the other. So our approach was, given that we have like 50 plus applications and different hardwares and everything, to create an abstraction layer, an abstracted SDK that can be used by all the product teams, and we below the stack will take care of. So my team said that we will take care of giving you the best performance on the hardware that you are looking for, and we chose different frameworks for different hardware. So our approach was that we will use CoreML for Apple devices, we will use WinML for Microsoft devices, and we will use TF-Lite for Android. And so far, with all the things that we did, they seem to be working good. Other than the challenge that came with each of these technology, which is each one of them themselves are not mature technologies. They are also emerging. So the support that they have, the tools that they have, is very, very minimal. There's, like, we see all these examples that come up that, oh yeah, take this mobile net and it's giving you this much performance on Android and this performance on iOS and this performance over here. The moment you start working with the real models that are huge, that have real operators, the first challenge that comes up is that you're not even able to convert it into any of those frameworks. The operator support is just very minimal. So you go like batch normalization, oh, that's not there. Oh, this, oh, that's not there. So you start with that. So first of all, you figure out like, okay, the support is minimal. So maybe some of the basic operators that you as a company need, you can develop those. But even then, when you are then trying to compile the whole thing, you will, like, at least in our case, and maybe things have become better, but I'm talking about like when we were doing it in, you know, March and April, we were having like compilation errors, we were having all kind of issues, and so most of the time you were able to convert it into one form, but you're never able to convert it into the other form. There is no, you know, interoperability between TF-Lite and CoreML. So this was a big challenge, and I feel that this is still a challenge at this point, where the conversion is not smooth. People are going for some of the standards like Onyx and stuff, but not everybody is building on top of it. So in fact, conversion between WinML and CoreML was much more smoother than between TF-Lite and CoreML, or TF-Lite and WinML. So those were really some of the, this area I feel is still evolving, and one of the most challenging thing that we worked on. So the way we did was we created our own in-house converter using some of the operators that Adobe needs. And then we also created an evaluator, because you convert it, but now when you actually run it on one device or the other, there's no comparison. And I'm not even talking about latency. Even the results apparently come up differently because each of the operator is implemented in a little bit different way in each of these frameworks. So now, if it is all about weights and how things are working, the final result itself sometimes was different. So can we create something where we can give users an evaluation between these different frameworks was a big challenge. And we did some work over there, but again, it becomes hard because based on the use cases, where it is gonna run, the people that we are targeting, you might want to optimize it in a different way. So if we feel that most of the folks who are, and this is again a very specific use case for us, like use Android are in the Asian market, right? And whereas people over here use more iPhone, then, but now, and the files that they deal with might be different over there in that geo, and the files over here might be different, then you might want to optimize it a little bit different because you know that the inputs over there is different than the inputs over here, and the hardware is different. So it's a little bit very, you know, it's just a thing about how do you create that least common factors and bring it as an SDK to optimize across these use cases. But so we did have some optimizers and people and the product teams to do this kind of a trade-off, like, am I looking for more accuracy? Am I looking for, you know, small sizes? And then, so other thing that came up, which was something that we struggled a lot, was because people come and they will say that, why don't you just train a new model that is much smaller? Why do you want to convert it? But the, okay, if it was one model or two models, maybe that is an approach that you can go with. You can retrain the model, you can collect the data. We are talking about hundreds of models that we already have on cloud. We are already talking about some of the very, very complicated models that were built to make sure that certain feature is solved. Now, to rebuild it starting from the scratch is almost like redoing the whole project again. So again, like for us, the problem is thinking of it at scale, the bringing up a solution at scale. So that is what we were trying to get to. And so conversion was important for us. So it's not like we can go away from conversion and just retrain everything. And that's why we had to put a lot of effort into getting this custom operators and evaluation and tuning and optimization together. Still a lot more work needs to be done. So now we had abstraction layer, we had frameworks, we had the models that can be changed, and now the real problem of really figuring out how do we make it so that it works for all the users. Even when we had tested in most of the hardwares that we supported, suddenly we realized that some of the users don't even have a GPU on their phone. They are on such old hardware. Even the frameworks like WinML at that point did not support a much older version of Windows, and we had to go back and they did it. But so we had to think of alternatives. But the good thing, and this is an important lesson, was because of that abstraction, it was very easy for us to bring in another framework like OpenVINO from Intel, which was like highly, highly optimized for CPU versions for laptops, and that really helped us. So really thinking of like how do we do it, and the other challenge was that when you package it as an application, and if the size is too big, it takes it much bigger, like it makes it much difficult for you to not only download it, but also make it difficult for you to pass it in the store because they check for your sizes and everything. Also, what we did was that instead of making so many versions of your application and then upgrading it every time a new model comes back, we had a option of downloading it on demand only when the users are using it, and then based on the hardware that the request is coming on, we can make the choice that what is the best model to download for them and then make it work. Also, this gives us a good option of just downloading the models that are really needed. So even if you have like 100 of features that are using 100 models, you can really keep in memory just the 4 or 5 models that the user is using for. So optimizing based on the usage, optimizing based on the devices, and really doing all of that heavy lifting of creating so many versions and different aspects of that on the server side. Even after doing all of that, sometimes you have to make a decision that these features or this functionality won't not be supported, and only a small version of it will be supported. And if they really need to go for the bigger one, they upgrade their hardware or they connect to the cloud, so to do something. So some of those trade-offs had to be made, and it's not always easy, because in most of the time you want to keep your apps and features consistent across all the everyone and all your users, but at least given where we are right now, this was an important thing that we had to work with. Another important thing that we did as part of this was, which was a little bit more challenging, was that we have different apps. Like, we have a Photoshop app, we have a After Effects app, and we have, an Illustrator app or something, which may be very specific to Adobe. But all of these apps can use the same model. So like, if you're using a masking, it can be used in Photoshop, it can be used in... Now, do we want to really create 3 different versions for each of the app, or do we want to share it? But now you are talking about sharing of data between the apps, which inherently is not allowed. So how do you do that and all of those things? So once you come to really building something which is real and which is going in the real world, it's very different from when you are, trying to just do a POC or taking a small specific use case and trying to put it on a device and showing it to you. Yes, please.
How do you insulate yourself when the inference libraries update and that creates challenges downstream back into some of the development? So if a release of Core ML comes out and the users update that Core ML and it starts to break things?
So most of the time, at least, okay, so CoreML is good in a way that it's, so far we have not seen challenges with the backward compatibility with CoreML. I don't know if there are any Google folks here, but TF Lite has not been a very good friend. It does break with incompatible changes. But I think it's not more from the user perspective, because this SDK that we build, it's bundling the libraries, the framework libraries with it. So whatever we support is the one. And then our team is taking the responsibility of seeing when the new versions are coming. And then we update our versions when the new ones come in and make it happen. So even if the user updates their library on their devices, but our functionality is using the one that is bundled in the SDK. So it kind of, take it from there. Actually, I didn't mention it, which is an important thing, is around the encryption of models, because now that it's going on the user devices, one of the big concern that everybody has, that these models, proprietary IP models, that's how do we want to really, so we have it encrypted, and then basically it does do the decrypt it only in the memory. And so we have to take care of all of those things, because that's something that you have to be careful. It's going under the same rigor as any other application code or software code that you write. Like, you send out the binaries, you have to make sure that it's not, somebody can just, work it and then get the code. So those were mostly the technical challenges and support and everything else. But one of the big challenges that we saw was the execution challenge. And the reason was that when we started, and nobody knows what the solution is look like and what are we going to do and how will this really affect, you don't get that kind of, like, you're not going to have 20 or even 50 people team. Like, if you look at the teams at Google and Apple, they are that big. But when we started, we had like a small team. Okay, you go ahead and you make this happen. So it was a lot like a startup kind of a culture, which is good for me because I come from startups. So I like doing that. But there was a big challenge just because there were so many use cases, so many different scenarios that we had to do. So I think what I'm pretty proud of the way we approached it is like we created almost an internal open source. So in the sense that all the teams that were looking in there, they were from the very beginning part of this project. And it wasn't that they have to do everything, but they kind of had a, you know, say in it, they were looking at it, they were checking in code. And I think that was one of the big wins for us because we created something that was actually at scale helping a lot of different products and use cases. So that was there. We ourselves as a team took some of the use cases across the domain. So we took a image related use case, we took a video related use case, we took, you know, different, so that we are covering a wide variety, a wide range of use cases that we had to do. And not very happy with that, like in the sense that we had to do a lot of communications, which basically means a lot of meetings and like spending time into getting things. But I don't think that we could have avoided it in any which way, and it would have just led to more challenges. So all in all, I think it was a pretty big challenge that we took as a small team. And I think we learned a lot during this journey. But some of the lessons which might, you know, will be helpful for you all to think if you are thinking in those directions, that what might be the right way to go if you want to use the ML on devices. Definitely, this is a paradigm shift that is happening now from cloud, machine learning, big models, you know, lot of infrastructure. You again have to think of smaller resources, smaller models. Also, I think there's definitely a need for new standards and protocols because just having such a variety of frameworks and everything, it makes it difficult for other folks to start using it at the scale that we would want to, not like, you know, only concentrated to the big players out there. And then there are a lot of opportunities like that personalization in terms of research, like federated learning, like how do you first learn just on the personal device at a personal level? What information do you want to send it back to the cloud to update the global model and make things happen? Like there's a lot of research over there because again, there is a big balance and then what kind of weights or information that you want to send. So again, there is a need of like defining those kind of protocols, like how should that information go back to the cloud? How should it get updated and things around it? Auto ML again is a big thing because like I said, conversion is a big problem. And even though Auto ML, like everybody has their own definition of maybe transfer learning or doing it at something, for me, I feel like taking a big model and making a smaller model out of it by looking at the devices, the architectures, and learning it on your own without like having to go with a lot of manual steps, like seeing which layers are not useful, which can be compressed, where can you change the floating point into an integers, and all of those things, if you can do it automatically and then really make the smaller model out of a bigger model that will work across the devices, there's a great opportunity over there. So definitely a big, big opportunity and something that is we will see a lot more. And that is all on my side. And this is my Twitter handle in case if you want. And there's a lot going on Adobe Sensei site. So if you want to follow up over there. Thanks. And any questions?